Let's return to the wonderful tool that is provided with Oracle Express, and let's go on with the exploration of its administration part. After storage, there is memory. Remember that we are limited to 1 GB of memory, which is a comfortable 25% of the amount of user data that you are allowed to manage in this edition of Oracle. Memory utilization shows how much is devoted to the System Global Area, or SGA, and how much to the Process Global Area, or PGA. Once again, for details, you may refer to my video on Oracle architecture. It's almost impossible to give guidelines about memory. It really depends on what you are trying to do with the database. You'll probably need more PGA if you have many concurrent sessions. That's about the only thing that can be safely said. Manage SGA is about as useful as at the previous screen. No need to worry about memory as long as you have no running application to observe. So, let's move on to user management. And here, we can find a single user called HR. The little clock means expired, which in the Oracle context means that the password has expired, and if you could connect, you would be required to change it immediately. The padlock means that the account is locked, and that you cannot connect anyway. I assume that while doing this, you are connected as system. You have also seen in a previous video that when you connect to SQL Plus as SysDBA, you are connected as user Sys. And you have seen when I talked about space management that when you create a database, it comes with many tables that belong to different owners. Might it be that once again the tool is economical with the truth and we have more than one user? Once again, let's query the data dictionary. And in that case, after having set the number of lines displayed to 20, the view called DBA_users. Surprise, there are many users. Three are open accounts. We know Sys and System. Anonymous is an account that is required to use Apex and this web-based tool in particular. Since the application is stored in the database, including the login page, there is a chicken and egg problem that is solved by user Anonymous. There is no way to connect to Anonymous otherwise than by using the web server. It has almost no rights and it's not a security threat. I have already talked about some of the locked accounts in the previous tutorial and I'm going to say a short word about the other ones. MDSys is used by a special option of Oracle to manage special coordinates. OUTLN stores outlines, a feature mostly useful in last resort attempts to salvage poorly written queries when you have no access to the code. DIP owns no tables, it's an account used by an advanced security feature. TSMSys is used for advanced session management in high availability environments. CTXSys is associated to full text indexing. DBSNMP is used by monitoring agents in big companies where there are many, many databases and where monitoring is centralized. Don't unlock any of them. Every hacker knows of these accounts and their default passwords, and some of them have the right to do many things when unlocked. How are user accounts managed in Oracle? Basically, you need to understand that you have regular user accounts and schemas. Schemas are accounts that create and own tables. The other accounts, if they have the suitable rights, can read the data that is stored in the tables and modify it. Of the three accounts that are initially open, Sys and System are schemas, and both accounts are DBA accounts that can do anything they want in the database. Sys is the most powerful user in the database because it owns the data dictionary, that is, the tables that describe all the other objects in the database. It even sees things that other DBAs can't see. Most locked accounts are also schemas, although some of them own just a handful of tables. User management in Oracle is based on privileges. You basically have two families of privileges. On one hand, you have privileges that allow you to change the structure of the database, which includes creating tables, but also user accounts and anything that you can find in an Oracle database. These are known as system privileges. On the other hand, you have privileges that allow you to access data. They are collectively known as table privileges, even if they also include the rights to call stored functions, for instance. As a DBA, you are only concerned with the first family of privileges. Usually, table privileges are granted to the other users by the table owners. System privileges are very numerous. I'm going to talk about roles very soon, there is a role called DBA that has all possible system privileges. To allow an already existing account to connect to database, you can use the grant create session 2 command, and you can give a lot of rights by issuing many grant commands listing all of the privileges. They can be combined. The problem is that if you grant privileges directly to users, if another account must have exactly the same set of privileges, then you must issue the grant commands again. This is why Oracle have introduced roles, which are created by a simple create role command, and to which you can grant privileges as if they were users. You can then grant a simple role to any user. It's also very convenient for maintenance, because any change to the privileges of the role is automatically reflected in all users that have been granted the role. Now that I have explained briefly users and roles, let's return to the administration tool and to the Create Database User panel. I just want to point out that the tool doesn't let you change the default table space. I have told you that usually you don't want all tables to be created in users, and I have shown you how to create other table spaces. I am also going to show you how to get over this. Another thing to notice, you can also ask for the password to expire immediately, which will require the user to change it at the first connection. Before you happily check the box, just think that if there is a password change, then the application must not only handle a special error saying that the password has expired, but also provide a way to change it. SQL Plus does, the administration toy does, but I've seen many applications that don't. Creating a user in SQL is a simple operation. Create user, the username, identified by a password which is not given between quotes, the temporary table space for sort operations, and a default table space in case the user would be allowed to create a table and would not specify the table space in the create table statement. When you have done that, the user is still a kind of shadow user, no way to connect until you give him the create session privilege. Then, the user is able to connect and can execute an alter user command followed by his own username to reset his password. For a schema, it's a bit different. Suppose that we want the tables in the forum table space to be owned by an account called forum schema. It's not enough to say that the default table space is forum. You must also say that the account is allowed to use storage in this table space by adding quota unlimited on forum. Like the previous user, this account will not be able to connect before it is granted the create session privilege. And even with an unlimited quota in table space forum, it will be unable to create a table before it receives the create table privilege. This brings us back to user management in the web-based tool, where after having defined a username and a password, you are expected to specify the system privileges and where two roles, connect and resource, are conveniently checked. I have to say something about the three roles, connect, resource, and DBA. If you check the Oracle documentation about them, you see that they are provided for compatibility with previous releases and that you are not supposed to use them. Compatibility with which releases? Well, if you want to know, this warning has been in the Oracle documentation since the late 1980s. These roles were introduced for compatibility with Oracle 5. If you manage to find somewhere, perhaps at the Vatican Library or at the Bodleian Library in Oxford, an old Oracle 5 manual, you will discover that at this time there were just three system privileges called Connect, Resource, and DBA. When the system privileges we are using today and the roles were introduced in Oracle 6, three special roles were created for compatibility. Needless to say, this was a time that is long past and gone. But I'm nevertheless going to give you additional reasons not to use these roles, and I'm going to use a small SQL script for that. When I invoke the script, I'll pass on the command line a username that will be substituted to the parameter. In the first part of the query, I list the privileges that were directly granted to the user. In the second part, I walk the tree of roles granted to the user, it's a tree because you can grant a role to a role, and return the privileges inherited from the various roles. This is a script you may find useful for audits, and which I saved under the name sysprivs.sql. To show it in action in SQL Plus, I check the system privileges of the anonymous account, just create session, that was directly granted. Now I am going to create two users, one that I call ConnectUser and one that I call ResourceUser, and as you were probably expecting, I grant Connect to ConnectUser and Resource to ResourceUser. Let's check the privileges of ConnectUser. As you can see, Connect is in practice nothing but a synonym for CreateSession. Now, let's check the privileges of ResourceUser. Much more privileges, and in particular something weird that I don't want. By granting this role, a direct privilege was also granted, and this privilege is unlimited table space, which means that the user can create tables in any table space, including system, including SysOx. Not something I want. Always give users what they need, but nothing more. Therefore, say quota unlimited on one table space, but don't use unlimited table space and don't use role resource. It's also interesting to compare the other privileges that are granted by resource to the list of privileges you can directly grant, which is a better list in my view. Only 5 privileges appear in both lists. Create table, of course, create procedure, create sequence, create trigger, and create type. So, what should you do? Firstly, don't give the DBA role to anybody. You already have 2 DBA accounts, Sys, which you should not normally use except for starting up the database, shutting it down or some really special operations, and system that you should use for most routine administration tasks. Secondly, I have already told you that you basically have 2 types of accounts, regular users and schema owners. The only system privilege that regular users need is create session, nothing more. For schema owners, you can create a role schema owner. What privileges do we want to give it? Create table, obviously, which also gives the right to create indexes. Create view, as views can be a good security device. Create sequence to create alternate keys when the key of a much referenced table is made of several columns. Create procedure to create functions, procedures and packages. Create type for advanced procedures mostly. Create role to be able to grant table privileges to roles. Create synonym can be useful. And create public synonym so that table owners can define a database-wide name for their objects. That's all. Anything else should be discussed case by case. There are 3 other privileges that can be considered normal system privileges for a schema owner, but that I don't really consider to be standard privileges. Create trigger. There are legitimate uses for triggers, but too often they are used to fix database modeling issues, and I'd rather be convinced that the privilege is really needed. Create database link allows to access data hosted at a remote database. I'd give it on an ad hoc basis, and the same is true of create materialized view that is often associated to database links. Now, how will it work? Well, I grant this role to the schema owner. It creates tables. It creates a role for regular users and for people who administer the application. It grants privileges to roles. Then, when users are created, the schema owner or system can grant the roles to the users. Then you can lock the schema account until the next application upgrade and let users query and modify the tables. I will no longer talk about the web-based application tool provided with Oracle Express, but you can find at this URL a tutorial that makes you fully explore it and in which you can help Shayla perform a number of tasks. I hope that now you'll understand better what is implied when Shayla clicks her way through. As far as I'm concerned, I still have things to tell you about backups, task scheduling and so on, but there is nothing about them in the web-based tool.